this is just kind of the idea of this is actually to have a casual conversation. So don't feel
so it's just what we're doing.
Yeah. Nice. All right.
Just talk shit about anybody you want. It's
okay. Okay. Good.
No problem at all. So this movie is kind of like one of the surprises of the festival, I think, so far.
Oh, good.
Good, yeah.
It seems to be a very female movie, even though it's got John at the center of it, in a way.
Yeah, it didn't dawn on me until we were doing an interview with all the ladies, you know, and it was India, and Rai was there, and Olivia, and then we realized there were just these stages of female coming of age and sexual awakening or confusion, you know, starting with the 16-year-old and the 24-year-old and the 26-year-old. But it was, you're right, there's just a lot of female power in there.
Yeah.
Which just seemed to be the same energy. You and, to me, you and Olivia's character are very similar before and afters, I guess.
Yeah.
But it seems like, you know, the whole inclusion of your first marriage suggests that you've been where she'd been and kind of know what
it's like.
Yeah, you
wonder, right, to what degree Julie was maybe oblivious of her actions, or, you know, you definitely knew that she had some things that she regretted and would have done differently, but to what degree, and this one has her whole life ahead of her to make a lot of mistakes, or...
So what was it like when you first read the script?
I loved it from the beginning. I thought it was great. Very unusual script. So it really drew me to it. And I actually was working, I'm working on this TV show at the moment, and there was this whole issue of timing and scheduling. And I fought to do this movie because I just thought the script was fantastic.
Do you see many scripts that you think are fantastic?
You know, there's some really great scripts out there. It's hard to find a character my age that's really well developed, because I think in most
my
scripts,
age too.
I think just most scripts, you know, the characters my age tend to either be really minor parts, or if they're main parts, it's sort of like, you know, the stereotypical teenage girl. So it was really unique in the sense that I felt like Colt, the character that I play, is too, you know, not a one-dimensional person. She has a lot of history and a lot of depth to her, so I really was happy to find something like that.
And kind of true for your character, too.
True for my character, too. I was really, the script had just got me really curious. Like, before I even knew it was John and Olivia and India and everyone, I was just reading it and I thought, gosh, why, you know, wow, a woman says to her husband, oh, I think you have a crush on our house guest, and then says, just don't embarrass me. I'm like, what's that all about? You know, like, I wanted to know more and see if we could figure out who these people are. Like, that's always an exciting challenge. It wasn't the big cathartic scenes or the big, you know, you don't get the limp and the hunchback, you know, but there was like a subtle...
Have you done a limp and a hunchback?
I'm doing it next.
That's coming up next.
Yeah, watch for it.
Richard S. the Third. But yeah, she has a lot of knowledge.
She does. Yeah, she's lived. She's lived in. And I've used this analogy the other day during the Q&A, but when I first read the script, I had an image of, like, you know when you have like a thread on your sweater, and like you could leave it or you could snip it, but if you pull it, sometimes the whole thing comes apart, and that's what it was. It's like really little, like the movie's delicate, you know what I mean? But there's a lot, like, you know, they're left with a lot to figure out when the movie ends.
But it was interesting to me. I mean, I thought that you and Olivia's character parallel each other, and I thought you and Olivia's actors, in a way, parallel each other, that you both kind of, we had this conversation with Olivia a little while ago, but that you kind of both blew into the scene as kind of architectural, typical, not sex bombs, but but women who men were drawn to in this kind of mysterious, interesting way. And that was really your first wide exposure through Mad Men.
You
like were like was an iconic character somehow in just a few episodes, really. Kind of had this weight.
I mean, I had nothing to do with that, but yeah.
But why didn't you have nothing to do with it?
Well, I just think it was such an interesting, like, the writing, you know, like Matt's, what he came up with, and
right.
And I think it, he sort of, he gave me some book when I did it called, I think, Memoirs of a Beatnik, and it was about this female beatnik and her having to sex with everybody, and it was just, I think a lot of it, like this script too, it's just interesting when you just give someone a role that isn't, because we see so much of the hair and the shoes and, you know, that kind of overt sexuality. And there are so many, I'm so much more drawn to, and maybe Olivia is too, and her, it's in this, for her as well, just this more subtle undercurrents, because, I don't know, I feel like we've gotten really excited about one idea of what's sexy. and they try to recreate that in movie mm-hmm. after movie, and that there's it's not really sexy.
Well, I mean, you both are playing in those situations, very intelligent. It's like an intelligence draw,
sure,
as much as a sex draw.
Yeah.
And that's not what men generally make movies about.
Right.
Generally, they're making about, you know, men acquiring women.
They're male fantasy movies. Yeah.
Well, there's certain men, obviously, who have this fantasy as well.
Yeah.
I mean, John married you in the movie. In the character. I mean, there are men who are drawn
and
to
my
that.
Real life husband has that fantasy.
And your real life husband, there you go.
Yeah. Thank goodness.
And you have a chalkboard in the bedroom. Like, write things down. E equals MC squared. Boom. Yeah. It's like magic. But it's an interesting thing. And I think you are... You also bring that fierce intelligence, it feels like, as a...
The poet, you know what I mean? She's got a real...
Yeah, and I mean, Colt definitely has that sort of artistic, intelligent side to her, which I think makes her interesting. And, you know, when she's going through these very sort of normal teenage experiences, she has a lot of emotions, but she also thinks about things in a way that a lot of people don't. And I think that really makes her a complex character.
Yeah, she really uses her mind, doesn't she, to, like, choose? Like, she's in love, she's a crush mm-hmm. on the one guy, the kind of unattainable guy. Mm-hmm. And then, like, in a very smart move, she says, no, this guy's more appropriate for me. You know, the Avi character. Yeah. She's, mm-hmm. like, really, like, you know, it's like, it's a visceral thing, but it's also, she's got her head on straight.
Yeah. And theoretically, this is how some women actually work.
Theoretically, yeah.
Not just what we see on TV or in the movies.
Yeah.
So, was the set fun? Was it an easy group to...
Yeah, I thought so. Yeah, I think besides the, I know you just interviewed Rye, and she's very smart and intuitive. She's also kind of like an old Jewish grandmother and always pinching your cheeks and telling you how beautiful you look and can I just hug you, can I just give you, like, but in between every take.
Yeah.
You know, so it was sort of this, like, kind of hippie love fest on the scene. It was very easy to, like, embody the world of the Bohemian Silver Lake because Seth felt a little bit like that.
Did you guys have any rehearsal time together, or?
Not really. No. I mean, I think what was actually nice is that we did enough takes that we kind of rehearsed through it as we were doing it, and so it changed. I feel like every time we did a scene, you know, each take was different, and I think that that's really great. And
that
it gives Rye
helps.
A lot of stuff to choose from. But, like, I was talking about the bedroom scene earlier, when I take your tea and we're saying goodnight. And I feel like that scene was so wonderful to shoot because we really did try it a few different ways and, you know, took our time with it in a really nice...
That was the rehearsal.
Yeah.
You know, in front of the camera, which is good. And for this movie,
it
was a budget thing, you know, probably essentially, but it works because we don't know Martine. You know what I mean? Like, the first, like, I don't know, you know, we find each other on the camera. John and I, you know, had to squeeze in a little sushi lunch, you know what I mean? To sort of say, how do you see the relationship? Yeah, figure out our marriage in 2 hours. But, you know, sometimes you have the luxury of rehearsal. Sometimes rehearsal's good, and sometimes it actually...
makes it stale by the time
and actors spend a lot of time talking about what they're gonna do. You know what I mean? And it doesn't actually really amount to much, but...
So in this case, it worked not to...
I think.
Have too much fun.
You don't know, because we have nothing to compare it to. You know, but it was... We had fun.
Yeah.
Well, you saw the movie.
Yeah, no, but we're not objective. You know what
That's
I mean?
True.
And we didn't do it the other way. We didn't rehearse it and do that version of it. But I think it was... It felt... like it fit the dynamic.
Yeah.
To because there were a lot of disconnects and stuff. And even in the marriage with John and I, there's something off there. So it worked better to not be so chummy with John.
Right.
I did have to call because I had done a movie with his wife earlier. I did have to call and be like, I have to make out with your husband. I'm so sorry. You know, but.
But you got to make out with her too, so. Can you? Whoosh. Oh, wrong movie. You know, we missed you in Toronto. We shot Mark and. And Lynn and Emily without you. It's very sad.
I love that movie too.
It was fun.
Yeah.
Well, you know, it's funny, the more I've been at the festival this year, the more I kind of want to see that movie again.
Yeah.
It's like, I haven't gone back this trip because.
You guys see some movies you can't really do it, but I've really learned with these movies, like the third time's a charm. You know, like you see like sometimes a rough cut and then we see it with the audience mm-hmm. and you're still trying to take it all in and then the third time you get to experience it like the audience does and it's cool.
Are you shy about watching yourself on camera?
You know, as I get older, not so much, but I think there's a level of detachment where I don't feel that much ownership mm-hmm. over it. While I'm working, I feel incredibly like an advocate for my character, mm-hmm. but once it's out there, you know, you give it away, so I don't feel, so I don't so much. There might be some things that I do that I don't, if I don't like them, I just don't want to see them, but that's a different thing entirely. Yeah. How about you?
I hate,
you do.
Hate watching myself. As soon as I come on screen, I hide behind my hair.
Yeah.
I'm just very critical, and I always think like, oh, I could have done that this way, I could have done that that way, and
well,
I
that's
can't.
Good. Yeah.
Yeah, no, it actually is helpful. I mean, once I actually force myself to sit down and watch, I think it helps me learn a lot from sort of, you know, what did I do wrong, what can
me too.
I fix.
Yeah.
But there's that sort of first emotional gut reaction where I just go, oh no, don't look.
Yeah.
But you're reacting to your work, not to your dimples or whatever that you.
Yeah, no, my work mostly, yeah.
All of the above.
Yeah, it really
although
is.
Which
it's
you look
so
like her,
hard
right?
not to yeah. be critical
yes,
of everything.
Of
yeah, exactly.
I know, it's so hard for you to look at yourself on camera.
Yeah.
That, what's that woman doing up there? brutal. So is it easy shoot?
Pretty much, yeah. I'm trying to think if there was anything that was really.
We had some long days, but even that was fine. Yeah. I mean, for me at least, I didn't.
But
mind.
Those are the moments where it really comes together. Like
yeah.
the party scene
like a
was a really long. I think I remember like John had to get on a plane at one
yeah.
point at the very end because we went so over. You know, like we were supposed to stop at like 1 a.m. at 5 a.m. We were still going, and he had to go, and I had to do that moment where I see. He and Martine dancing.
Without him there. Yeah,
oh, without anybody
yeah.
there. You know what I mean? And the, but you're so in it at that point because we've been at that party
right.
for, you know, 18 hours. So you think you see them,
yeah.
you know.
And did Justin come in and pretend to be your ex-husband, your husband? Was working with Justin fun?
yeah, I love Justin. I could watch him
like
in every movie.
Every time he does anything, it seems like he's having so much fun.
He's having so much fun, and he makes it look so easy. Like, there's no moment where he just needs a moment to, like, regroup. It's just always flowing and always... Yeah. And there's a lot, you know, obviously, in any movie that's not in the movie that ends up on the cutting room floor, like, because, you know, the movie has to pace it up or whatever. He's... I wish everything that he does is in there, because I find it so interesting and delicious.
So, and who was hard to work with on this movie?
I don't know if there was anyone hard to work. I mean, I know that sounds so silly, but I'm being totally honest. I don't think that there really was anyone that
John
was...
John Krasinski is such a diva, as I know you can tell from his personality, so that was hard, because he's so serious. No, it was easy, right?
Yeah, it really was. Yeah.
Did you have long discussions with the director about what you were doing and what was going on?
I did, actually. Rye was fantastic about that. I feel like she really knew what she was looking for, and she had a really good sense of sort of the history of the character and all of the motivation, so it was really nice to talk to her, and she was still open to suggestions, too. So just to sit down, and even while we were doing the scene, say like, okay, this works because of this, but we have to change this line because I think from where she's coming from, she wouldn't really say it that way, and it was a great experience.
Have you had many experiences with directors working that closely or openly?
Not, I really have very rarely experienced a director telling me, you know, this is what I think the motivation is, what do you think? That's a very unique thing, and I think that Rye does an amazing job with that. So.
And have you had any directors ask what you think recently? Maybe?
No.
Is all this what you hoped it would be?
This movie?
This TV and movie world that you live in now?
Yeah, I mean, you know, I love acting so much, like I really do. Like I feel so lucky to get to do this that, you know, it's just the trick is always just to try to find the great material. And yeah. I do feel like that's the part I can't believe is when I get to work with, you know what I mean, like somebody great and then somebody else great, and or I'm like really floored by the script. The other stuff, I don't even really know what the other stuff is, but when you say the world of it.
What do you think about it? Are you a careerist at this point at all? Or
what is that? What is that, a careerist?
I don't know. Thinking about where you're going to be, what I need to attain this and get this kind of part and do this kind of thing, and this is how I see my career in 5 years. And
no, I think I spend a little bit more time like being really inspired by watching someone take, you know, maybe be more involved in the collaboration, or say I have an idea, you know, working with Mark Duplass. I mean, he is, you know, a storm of like, I have a whole drawer full of ideas. I'm going to make this movie. I'm going to make it for $2. I'm greenlighting it myself. Lately I've been drawing inspiration from like just that kind of thing. Saying I'd like to maybe try that. You know what I mean? Or I haven't even seen her, but I heard like Brie Larson, who I did United States of Terror with, directed a short here. Like that kind of stuff. So it's not really where do I see myself in 5 years, like, oh, I want to do another series. It's more, I want to, God, that's a really inspiring person, and they think they can do it, you know, and they're doing it, and I wonder, if I could do that, maybe.
So do you think you will?
I think. I'll try.
It's not such a bad thing. It's not so hard.
Yeah.
I guess. I mean, it's weird. It's funny how it's like it does seem like the Duplasses, he and his wife, had infected everybody in Los Angeles, and this, you know, now this cult is kind of growing in L.A. where everybody's going to end up directing.
Yeah, well, they're really, really generous, you know, because I think they want to. They have a friend who, I'll introduce you because then you could do it too. You know, they'll have a friend who has an idea for something, and then they'll say, I know a writer who, and maybe I'll direct that. Or Mark will say, I don't want to direct. I don't want to give a big chunk of my year to that, but I'll put you in touch with. And they are developing sort of a commune of sorts of creative people, but it's good.
Yeah.
Right? You know?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I know that Lynn and everybody was very excited that you came on to so late onto Your Sister, and they felt you kind of made it all work after.
Yeah, this was one where I got the call on Saturday morning, can you start shooting on Tuesday?
Wow.
On an island off of Seattle, you know, while I was shooting a TV show. I was saying, I'd probably start shooting on Tuesday. Do you shoot on the Paramount lot where I'm working every day? But that was just, again, like you do with your TV show.
Yeah.
If you want to do it, I feel like the producers who usually get a bad rap of saying no, 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 just go, oh, we got to let her do it. She loves it so much. So.
Yeah. And do you have any ambitions that way, or do you have career ideas, or are you kind of
waiting to see what comes? My, you know, as far as my career is concerned, if it's good material, that's all I'm really looking for. I don't really care if it's small, if it's big, whatever. I just want to try something that, you know, something I'm really passionate about, a project that really feels like it's a very strong, interesting thing to me. That's what's really important. And one of the things that I love about, one of the reasons why I act is I always, you know, going through my life, I feel like, oh, I wish I could try everything. And acting sort of gives you that opportunity to be everyone and try everything. And so that's what I would really love to do with my career, is do a number of different roles that are very, you know, not like myself at all.
So did you both see the film before the premiere yesterday?
Did you see it?
No, I didn't see it.
I saw a cut of it, and I will say that this was, maybe it's because the sound is such a big component in it. But this was one where I was like, you have to see it with the music and the sound, because it really is another character in the film. Like, the whole feel of the film felt different to me.
Mm-hmm.
Or same with Your Sister. I didn't realize it was such a comedy. And then you watch it with an audience, and you're like, oh my God, it's funny, you know? So, it's different than what, you know, I was really struck this time by, because, you know, we're all watching screeners or things on our computer, and it's just different on a big screen when you see the little moments, and you just hope that we're still doing that 20 years from now.
And hearing the audience react to it is also like,
yeah.
You can hear them stop breathing, you can hear them start breathing.
Yeah, in the circuit just now that everyone was crying, you could hear, you know, across. Or in The Artist, I don't know if you guys saw that in the theaters, like there were parts that were truly silent and the audience was laughing, and I had a moment like, oh, this is what it was like, you know, back in the day, and we got to have that experience.
Exciting. And so were there surprises for you when you saw the picture?
Yeah, I mean, I guess my main surprise was that reading the script, it was sort of more of a comedy, and then seeing it now, I mean, it certainly has funny moments, but it is more of a drama, and I think it actually works very well that way. I think Rye really took the best of the material she had and crafted a great film. So.
And to Rye's credit, when you say, have you seen it before, there were big surprises for me from a cut just from a month ago to now, because Sundance, you're working furiously in color correcting until the last minute. That, I mean, and this probably happens all the time, the scene orders just shift, and the movie makes so much more sense. And it ends on a different, like the last cut I saw, the last scene with Julie and Martine was before Peter goes out and gives the kids grilled cheese. And for some reason, reversing them
makes it a whole
different animal.
Yeah. Well, they said the beginning changed significantly, apparently, from the earlier cut.
I mean, I don't know. I don't have a cut list.
List of which cuts there were.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, there have probably been so many versions of it. But
so it sounds like you're still a movie fan.
I'm a real fan, yeah. I am, yeah. I mean, I go in and out. I don't feel like... I feel so old sitting next to India.
No!
I'm sorry. Because I keep thinking, like, you know, when I was in my 20s, I saw everything. You know, I'd go see, like, so many things. It's like theater, movie, like everything. And now I'm a little bit more... I don't mind missing things. You know, I don't mind, like, just having a weekend where I don't do any, you know, or just watch the Chicago Bears or something like that. But when I'm here, I realize, like, I said, oh, you have a two-hour lunch. I'm like, do I have time to see something? You know, because as much as it's about the parties and the this and, you know, that, it really is about the movies. And it's, you can't believe how many talented people are here right now.
You should listen to her.
Yes. No, I...
How so?
No, I mean, I think this is a good advice. I mean, have you had a chance to see any other movies at this point?
I haven't. I really wanted to. I tried to make it to one, and my plane was delayed, and I got there, like,
likely
10 minutes
story.
Late. It was terrible. I was really disappointed.
I didn't the first time I came. You know what I mean? It's more of a thing that you just... In the beginning, I was like, well, I was just too nervous just to do this interview.
Yeah, and I didn't even know how... I had no idea how it was going to work.
Yeah.
I didn't know exactly how the interview process worked and the press worked, and I thought it was going to be like a vacation, and then I realized
she's doing amazing, right?
It's not quite
like
a vacation.
This is our first press junket.
And how's that going? Are you enjoying it?
Yeah, I am. I mean, it was. I didn't know what to expect, but I think it's a good experience. So,
have you not done press stuff before with other
a little bit, but certainly not like this, and not so many interviews in one day or 24-hour period.
Have you been asked a really, really stupid question yet?
Not here. I have in the past been asked some bad questions that I wasn't prepared for. Someone asked me what I thought of Justin Bieber, and I didn't know who he was, and I said, who? Justin Bieber? And they're like, no, that's not right.
But moving on.
Yeah, and that was sort of embarrassing because I still had no idea who they were talking about when I left the interview. I was like, I don't know what I just said, but it wasn't right.
No, it's definitely a good thing to dive in when you have the opportunity.
Yeah.
It's one of the tragedies of film festivals, I think, that people don't, talent comes, and they end up like stuck in a junket cycle, and then they're out. And then, you don't get to go to the movies. And the thing that's actually fun about this, as much as it's nice talking to everybody, is the movies. You know, it's such a thrill when you kind of discover something that you weren't expecting or didn't know to expect, and all of a sudden it's on you.
Yeah.
And it's real. It's beautiful. It's the reason why I guess I keep doing it all these years.
Well, and it really is. Like, they showed a short before one of the films the other night. I think it was like a Swedish film called Swamp or something. It was pretty crazy and funny. Short, super short. But all of a sudden I said to my husband, I said, was that one camera angle? And I think it was two, but then you realize, like, you could make a movie for $2 because all they needed was a kitchen and a window, and they had two cameras. Mm-hmm. And they had a really neat little movie, and so, but just things you wouldn't think of. If maybe you have a story you want to tell and say, I can't make it, and then you remember that movie and you said, they did. Or you get to talk to that filmmaker and say, how did you do it? And
that's so cool.
And the audiences here really do want to know how you made your movie and how the script, like how you developed it, and if you took it to the lab, and how do they support you. And
well, and what the idea is, which in commercial cinema you kind of forget. It all becomes about the commercial and what blows up best.
Yeah.
And just the idea of talking about ideas and having movies that are about ideas, and not just about big money and explosions is lovely. Sometimes it's horrible.
Yeah.
For every great one, there's three terrible ones, but that great one is just so great.
And it's great with these little movies too, when people start to say, and they're probably self-protective when they're saying, like, well, our movie's not for everybody, and they say that line. But the thing is, a lot of the movies that I think don't work are because they try to make a movie for everybody.
Mm-hmm.
And it's nice to come here and have people say, no, I just really wanted to tell this story. I knew it wasn't going to be for everybody, but they really told that story. And then sometimes it ends up being for everybody because it's so well done that it's undeniable.
But I think more and more it is that things can be niche and still do enough business to be successful.
Yeah.
But it doesn't have to be for everybody. And the idea that, every movie has to be for every audience is kind of bad for movies.
Yeah.
It's bad for movies, and it's bad for the people involved in them, because those are the moments you don't want to act anymore.
I think it's bad for the audience too, honestly, because it makes you one of this huge mass that doesn't get to experience anything personal anymore. So I don't think it's good for anybody. But.
Yeah. Stop it.
Make it stop.
I did tell a filmmaker earlier this week that my wife hated his movie. I fuck him up. Because we were talking about just that thing about niche films. And, and I said, my wife and I were watching the movie and she made me turn it off because she couldn't stand another second of it. But I really liked it. I went off in the other room and watched the rest of it.
And it's so interesting because it's on any given day.
Yeah.
Like, you could hate a movie and then watch it a couple years later and this is great. I wonder why I didn't respond to it then. It's because it's so what's going on with you and what you're projecting onto all those people up there.
That's why I see most movies that are of any significance twice. Because that second time you find out whether you were tired or happy or you need too much credit or not enough credit or and the great movies, when you think about it, Coen Brothers, the Kubricks of the world, it's always better the second time, third time, fourth time.
True.
It doesn't even make sense the first time usually.
Well, it's hard to get the story. I mean, you're fighting for you know, if it's a good movie, mm-hmm. you're working yeah. in there, and then you get to watch it again, and then especially if you're a fan, you get to say, oh my God, that's one shot.
And you
that's
pick a 9-minute
shot,
yeah,
no, you know, or great. Something, and it's one yeah. move, and then your mind yeah. is blown. Yeah.